disappear into the putter's ground. When the man comes around, hear the trumpets, hear the pipers, 100 million angels singing, multitudes are marching to the big kettle drum. Voices calling, voices crying, some are born and some are dying. It's Alpha and Omega's kingdom come. And the whirlwind is in the thorn tree. The virgins are all trimming their wicks. The whirlwind is in the thorn tree. It's hard for thee to kick against the pricks. Till Armageddon, no shalom, no shalom. Then the father hen will call his chickens home. The wise men will bow down before the throne. And at his feet, they'll cast their golden crowns. When the man comes around.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome to our first ever YouTube live, as Facebook has failed us again tonight.
Yes,
We have switched to a new team.
Yes,
YouTube is our live streaming team. If indeed it's working,
We'll find out.
We'll find out. Yeah. Anyhow, the subject tonight: the holy place and what it means for us today. We've been doing a study for several weeks now on the sanctuary. And tonight we're going to finalize our discussion and study on this topic. So, before we begin, Rowdy, could you lead us in a word of prayer, please,
Indeed,
brother?
Indeed, we can.
Proceed.
Father, we desire to be like David, that the thought of coming into your sanctuary, into your presence, would cause us to rejoice, and that our greatest desire would be to seek to dwell continually in your presence.
Yes.
And this is what is represented throughout the sanctuary service. It is a divinely ordained means of coming closer to you through a salvation process that you have put in place to teach us the way in which you work to redeem us and to draw us. It is true that your way, O God, is in the sanctuary, and your very presence is what makes that place and that process beautiful. So allow us to see you there tonight and to learn what is necessary to be able to dwell continually in your presence. This is our prayer tonight in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Psalm 77:13, Thy way, O God, is in the sanctuary. Who is so great a God as our God? Now this, simply put, is the reason why we've spent several weeks now delving into the study of the sanctuary. God's way is in it.
Yes.
And we're trying to learn how to recognize, how to determine sound, reasonable, biblical doctrine from the false doctrines that are out there. Mm-hmm. And primarily, this is done by studying God's Word. Secondarily, to those who have not had the opportunity to study the Old Testament deeply, lo and behold, All those doctrines are right there in the sanctuary for us to learn. Right. All the object lessons are there. The final study that we're doing tonight, we're going into that last compartment of the sanctuary. Mm-hmm. And there are some monumental doctrine that is relevant for us today that we must discern. Yes. From the most holy place, the holiest of all. Mm-hmm. Now, I'll confess the first part is going to be a little bit academic, but we're going to look at the most holy place. Now, general information. This is a small room. Started out in the tent-like structure that Moses carried through the wilderness. Ended up in Solomon's temple. The building that was constructed in God's honor. Conceived in the mind of King David, but completed by his son Solomon. Inside this room, we'll find the Ark of the Covenant and the mercy seat on top of the Ark. The cloud that followed, or actually that led Israel through the wilderness, mm-hmm. and the pillar of fire at night, mm-hmm. came from the Shekinah glory that set atop the mercy seat, mm-hmm. above the Ark of the Covenant, the earthly throne of God. So, this is the room in the most holy place to the north. Actually, it would have been in the west, right?
Yes, because they wouldn't face the east, the rising sun.
Correct. So, yeah, this would have been to the west. If the table of showbread is to the north, south, east, yeah, the most holy place and the Ark of the Covenant would have been to the west of the sanctuary. Here it is in a better picture, just to give you something to visualize as we study the sanctuary and the most holy place of it. Now, in Exodus 26, the most holy place, also called the Holy of Holies, where the Ark of the Covenant resided in the most holy place, and the Shekinah of glory rested on the lid of the Ark or the mercy seat. The measurements of the most holy place, the room itself was 15 foot squared, 15 by 15. I should say, I guess, 15 by 15 by 15. Mm-hmm. The high priest entered the most holy place. Now, this is an important detail.
Yes.
The high priest entered this holy place once a year, only one time. And it was called the Day of Atonement. Mm-hmm. And he would sprinkle blood on the mercy seat, or the lid of the ark. And this was to atone for the sins of the people. All of them. All Israel was cleansed from their sin by this act performed by the high priest once a year at the end of the year.
That's right.
The Ark of the Covenant was the box, obviously, to the west. In the most holy place. And what we learn about it. The ark was made of acacia wood, just like most of the articles in the sanctuary, and overlaid with gold. Inside and out with a gold crown or molding set around the top edge. There were four gold rings, just like all the other furnishings. One on each leg where they were to place the poles to carry the ark. The poles were acacia wood, also overlaid with gold. The mercy seat was set on top of the ark. The measurements of the ark: 2.5 cubits long, that's 45 inches, by 27 inches, by 27 inches. Another artist rendering of the Ark of the Covenant. Notice on top of the ark were two cherubs with their wings turned in towards the Shekinah glory. The contents of the ark are listed in Hebrews chapter 9, 4, and they show God's desire to protect, provide, and bring life to his people. These contents were the stone tablets with the Ten Commandments, a jar of manna, and Aaron's rod, which budded and bore fruit, showing God's power to bring life out of death. So these contents that were kept in the ark, the law on the tables of stone, was God's promise to you that he would provide his power to protect you from sin. Mm-hmm. Manna was the bread that came from heaven. Mm-hmm. God provides for your sustenance. Mm-hmm. And we know that Christ was also the bread that came down from heaven. Mm-hmm. So he provides for your salvation. Aaron's rod, this rod that he carried that miraculously budded and bore fruit, shows God's ability to miraculously bring power and life to you, even from a dead, sinful, godless experience. There is power in the Ark of God.
So Jesus fulfilled the law and protects all believers with his blood. Jesus provides us with the bread of life, which is eternal salvation. Jesus demonstrated his power over death by rising from the dead.
Amen. So this mercy seat was essentially the throne of God in the most holy place. It was also made of pure gold, and it had winged cherubs on each side facing each other with their wings outstretched above them towards each other. Mm-hmm. The mercy seat was beaten or hammered from one solid piece of gold, and it was placed on top of the ark. The measurements of the mercy seat were 45 inches by 27 inches. Annually, on the Day of Atonement, the high priest would sprinkle blood on the mercy seat to atone for the sins of the people. God offered mercy so sinful people could approach him, to the amazement even of the angels, the Bible tells us. Now, every year, once a year, at the end of the year, mm-hmm. the Jewish economy, a year was 360 days. At the end of that time, mm-hmm. that measure of time, which we refer to as a year, mm-hmm. there was this symbolic day, the day of at one meant mm-hmm. or atonement. Mm-hmm. Several things happened during this day. The high priest would go in, he would place blood on the mercy seat. Mm-hmm. There were a couple goats that were brought forward, one being the Lord's goat, one being a scapegoat. Mm-hmm. The sins of all the people, all of Israel, placed on the scapegoat. led by a fit man into the wilderness, mm-hmm. into utter darkness. Mm-hmm. This was all very symbolic. It was a very important day for the nation. There's a writer that shared some insight into this particular day, because not only would they perform these tasks in the sanctuary itself, but the people on that day were also, if you go back and read Leviticus 23, what you'll find is that the people were instructed also mm-hmm. to act differently mm-hmm. on the Day of Atonement.
That's right.
They were told to afflict your souls. Mm-hmm. Let me share this with you. What is it to afflict your soul? Moffat translates it this way: abstain and fast. This is what God's people were instructed to do during the antitype of the Day of Atonement. Unbelievers are eating and drinking, feasting and making merry, as it was in the days of Noah. And this author quotes Matthew 24, 37 to 29. They express their merriment in boisterous laughter and trifling song, disregarding the scriptures. Is any merry? Let him sing psalms, according to James 5, verse 13. They are restless and unhappy, unless they are being entertained by amusements that drown the conscious and unfit the mind for sober study of God's word. They do not realize the seriousness of the time. Like the rich man in the parable, they pull down their barns and build greater. And to their souls they say, soul, thou hast much goods laid up for many years. Take thine ease, eat, drink, and be merry. Poor souls, their riches cannot save them, for they are not rich towards God. This is the condition of the world
right.
at the end of time. And God's people are instructed in this last moment in time, in the true atonement time, mm-hmm. to afflict their souls,
yes.
which Moffat translates to fast and pray. Mm-hmm. Fast and pray. And in fact, that's exactly what the scriptures instructed the people to do that's on right. the Day of Atonement.
That's right. Which, if they did not engage in that work, regardless of all the sacrifices made for them, regardless of all the sacrifices they made throughout the year, if they didn't engage in that work of fasting and prayer and humiliation, humbling themselves before God, on that day, they were cut off.
Cut off from Israel.
That's right.
Put out of the camp.
That's right. So that informs us that there is a very specific type of lifestyle and attitude and work that we are supposed to be engaged in. Those of us who are living in the antitypical Day of Atonement, the Day of Judgment that we are in right now. Keep in mind that this Day of Atonement, this one day, represents a period of time at the end of Earth's history. The same way the entire sanctuary service, that entire process that repeated itself every year, represented the entire work of salvation. Right, for the human race.
That's
not
right.
just our individual experience, but God's work for all of the human race throughout history. And so we come down to the Day of Atonement, and that Day of Atonement represents the final phase of God's work, which is a time of judgment. That time of judgment is taking place before the high priest comes back out of the sanctuary like he did on the Day of Atonement. Remember, when he comes out, it's done. There's no more time left. It is finished, he will say. Let he who is filthy be filthy still. Let he who is righteous be righteous still. And behold, I come quickly. And that is what is represented in this Day of Atonement. So that Day of Atonement, the one day a year, represents a very particular period in Earth's history which falls under this idea of judgment, which is supposed to affect how we live and think and seek God.
So essentially what you're saying is, we're looking at the most holy place, and we're looking at the traditional cultural practices that were a custom for the Jews, instructed specifically by God. But this Old Testament sanctuary service is actually connected with a literal time frame at the end of Earth's history.
That's right.
Where God's people are going to have a similar experience to that was typified in the Old Testament sanctuary service in connection with Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement.
That's right.
I agree. And as we try to connect the old with the new here, we want you to experience and understand the application of this prophetic example that's given in Scripture with what we're to experience on the planet, those of us who are living at the end of time, as we approach the second coming of Jesus Christ.
Yes.
So that's why this particular portion of the sanctuary, and the study of it, to me, is the most exciting and the most important. Mm-hmm. Not that the other portions of the sanctuary weren't important. They were all extremely important. But this one meets home.
That's right.
This one meets us where we are today.
That's right.
Because I believe and am convinced that we're living just before the second advent of Jesus Christ.
Yes.
Just before he returns. And as he described, it would be like the days of Noah, mm-hmm. where they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage.
Right.
What he's calling us to do is, instead of being part of that revel rousing, mm-hmm. is to set ourselves apart, like on the Day of Atonement, mm-hmm. where there was an affliction.
Yes.
The people were to afflict their souls. They fasted, which means they changed the way their diet typically would be. They changed their diets. Mm-hmm. They dressed in sackcloth and ashes. Mm-hmm. So they humbled themselves in the way that they dressed. Mm-hmm. In their very clothing, they humbled themselves.
Yes.
So there's a dress reform. Mm-hmm. There's a health reform.
That's right.
A dietary reform. Mm-hmm. And just in general, a more solemn demeanor.
Mm-hmm. A spiritual and lifestyle change.
A serious devotion mm-hmm. for this particular time frame, an understanding of the seriousness of the time.
That's right.
Was the emphasis on the Day of Atonement. Mm-hmm. And this was typified or symbolically expressed every year mm-hmm. at the end of the year in the sanctuary service.
Yes.
To teach us who are actually living at the end of the age, mm-hmm. at the end of Earth's history, mm-hmm. in the last days before Jesus comes back. Mm-hmm. It's to express a message to you mm-hmm. about what we need to concern ourselves with. Mm-hmm. Living in the times in which people are losing their minds.
Yes.
So, those of you that have been watching the news, we've got all this stuff going on. A political election is underway. We've got impeachment in the House of Representatives. We've got crime and natural disasters galore. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Some more people were massacred this week by somebody.
Yeah.
Some more people were raped and murdered. It's a never-ending source of debauchery as you turn on the television from night to night,
mm-hmm.
of the horrible afflictions of living on this earth.
Right.
And it just seems to be increasing like birth pains on a woman about to give birth to a child.
Yes.
And this is what we're experiencing. Now, interestingly, the sanctuary isn't just an Old Testament phenomenon.
Right.
In the New Testament, you have the entire book of Hebrews, for example, where Paul basically walks through the sanctuary, mm-hmm. and makes application, mm-hmm. to the new Christians, the new converts to the way,
mm-hmm.
that are associated with the ministry of the Apostle Paul. Mm-hmm. The book of Hebrews focuses on the sanctuary and its application to Christian theology for the New Testament believer.
That's right.
Then you get to the book of Revelation, the book of prophecy,
mm-hmm.
and where does it begin?
With sanctuary talk.
In the sanctuary, Christ walking among candlesticks.
That's right.
So if you read through the book of Revelation, to many people it's difficult language.
Mm-hmm.
To a sanctuary scholar, which, by the way, any of you can become,
mm-hmm.
thanks to Google,
mm-hmm.
The entire book just follows Christ through the sanctuary.
That's right.
In connection with the prophecies that would be fulfilled at the end of time.
Mm-hmm.
Interestingly enough, there's some prophecy that most people are unaware of.
Mm-hmm.
I hear bits and pieces of it mentioned and quoted sometimes by Protestant Christians,
mm-hmm.
in their sermons of Bible prophecy. But very seldom do I see it expressed correctly.
Right.
And we want to take a look at that tonight. Some of you may be familiar with the story of a man named Daniel. Now, Daniel is one of Danny's favorite prophets in the Bible for obvious reasons. Our names are pretty similar. But Daniel is the key to understanding the book of Revelation, to understanding prophecy in general. But if you really want to understand the most holy place of the sanctuary, this prophet is key to understanding those prophecies,
mm-hmm.
to understanding the work that's being done in that sanctuary.
Mm-hmm.
And so, let's turn our Bibles. If you have a Bible,
mm-hmm.
I suggest you go get it, because you may want to do some highlighting tonight,
mm-hmm.
On this particular topic, because it is a powerful study. And I know I typically use PowerPoint and throw the scriptures up there on the screen for you to see. Tonight, we're going to do it the old-fashioned way. If you've got your Bible, go get it, because I want you to follow along. There's an interesting prophecy that starts in Daniel chapter 8. And immediately what we're going to find is some language connected not only with the sanctuary, but specifically with the most holy place of the sanctuary. So when you make it to Daniel chapter 8, go with me to verse 14. Okay? Daniel is shown a vision. And in verse 14... it's explained to Daniel that unto 2,300 days, then shall the sanctuary be cleansed. Now, the last couple words. The sanctuary cleansed. That is synonymous language mm-hmm. with Yom Kippur, with the Day of Atonement. That would happen once a year at the end of the year. Synonymous. Any Jew hearing the term cleansing of the sanctuary mm-hmm. would immediately, in their mind, go to one day. Mm-hmm. That special day, mm-hmm. the day at the end of the year, the day when they would afflict their souls and dress differently and eat differently mm-hmm. and act differently. Yes. On that day, a very peculiar day, different from the others. Mm-hmm. That's the day the sanctuary was to be cleansed. Mm-hmm. Any Jew, a mediocre Jew, mm-hmm. would know what this is about. Mm-hmm. We're not talking about a mediocre Jew.
That's right.
We're talking about a stud of a Jew.
Mm-hmm.
Daniel.
That's right.
Okay? So Daniel would have known what it meant to cleanse the sanctuary. Mm-hmm. The interesting thing is that this angel's telling Daniel that it's going to be 2,300 days. Mm-hmm. That's 2,300 days mm-hmm. until the sanctuary is going to be cleansed.
Right.
Now, hold on a minute. That doesn't make any sense because we do this every year.
Mm-hmm.
And a year is only 360 days.
Mm-hmm.
So, 2,300 days? That's a bunch of atonements.
That's right.
Down the road.
Mm-hmm.
So what is this angel trying to explain to Daniel? Now, what I could do is take you to the book of Numbers
mm-hmm.
or to the book of Ezra and show you scriptures that say that when God is speaking to us in a prophetic way,
mm-hmm.
that a day is to represent a literal year.
Right.
In which case, we wouldn't be talking about 2,300 days.
Mm-hmm.
We'd actually be talking about 2,300 years.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I think you might be able to give us a little clarification on this particular verse and what it says.
Yeah. You know, so there is a lot of controversy over this text of Scripture because some of us that understand the prophetic principles of interpretation understand that very concept, that when you're dealing with prophetic time, time that is encompassed in a prophecy, you always understand that as a day for a year. That's a pretty common and accepted method of interpretation historically, and it always has been.
Mm-hmm.
But there are some individuals that take issue with it, and their contention is this, that if a day-year principle was to be applied to this particular prophecy, then it would be stated in the text itself. We don't have to make an argument for or against that, Danny. Because
why is that?
Because what's interesting is the very language in the original language gives us the idea of 2,300 years right in the original text, the way it's meant to be interpreted. So that a year-day principle isn't even necessary. Because in the original language, with the original wording, the idea of 2,300 years is built right in. Mm. And it goes something like this. Let me back up just a little bit. I want to give a little more information. We're still in Daniel chapter 8. And I'm going to just skim a little bit. You can follow along. We're going to go to verse 8. And we had done some videos here in the last year on the prophetic kingdoms that existed. And so we touched briefly on this idea of the goat and the ram. And at the at the point here in Daniel chapter 8, this is what Daniel is seeing and hearing. Therefore, the he-goat waxed very great when he was strong. The great horn was broken, and in its place came up four notable ones towards the four winds of heaven. And out of one of them came forth a little horn. Now, this becomes the focus of the prophecy and all of the rest of the mess that is developed.
So you have the great horn, mm-hmm. which is a reference to Greece and its prominence.
That's right.
And Alexander the Great. Yeah. When Alexander dies, his four generals
yes.
take over the four divisions of Greece.
That's right.
But that doesn't stand because eventually...
Mm-hmm. Another little horn comes up.
A horn comes up, which historically, biblically, mm-hmm. prophetically, mm-hmm. represents a power.
That's right.
Typically a secular power, but we're going to see a difference as it moves forward at this last...
That's right.
At this last stage of history.
That's right. And this is what really troubled Daniel as we move forward. We'll see this. And this little horn, it waxed great to the host of heaven and cast down of the most... of the host of the stars to the ground and stamped upon them. He magnified himself even to the prince of the host. And by him the daily was taken away, and the place of his sanctuary was cast down. This is all reference to heaven and to Christ and the work against Christ.
Yes.
And we don't have time to go into all of it. I think we covered it pretty well in some of our previous videos.
I think so. Continue.
And a host was given against him, against the daily, by reason of transgression. It cast down the truth to the ground, and it practiced, and it prospered. And then I heard one saint speaking, and another saint said unto that certain saint which spake. And he asks a question, Danny. How long shall be the vision concerning the daily? Let's stop there for just a moment. There's a couple interesting things that I want to bring out. The one saint that spoke to the other saint. In Scripture, this other saint is identified very, very specifically and precisely in the original language as Palamoni, either the numberer of secrets or the wonderful number. And that word Palamoni is made up of two different words, Pele Mene. Pele is wonderful, and we've got a few verses that we can show. Christ is Pele. He is
Isaiah 9:6.
Exactly. He is right.
The wonderful counselor.
That's right.
Prince of Peace, mighty God.
That's exactly right. We have another, give me just a second here. We have another verse. I think I just accidentally closed it. When Samson was prophesied to be born, you remember the story?
Yeah, his father was approached by the same angel.
That's right. Yeah. The angel of the Lord. And he gave the prophetic promise that the son was going to be born. And Samson's father says, well, what is your name so that we can do you honor when this prophecy comes to pass? And the response is, why do you ask my name, seeing it is wonderful? It is Pele. Mene, you'll recall from the prophecy in Daniel.
Many, many tekel upharsin.
That's right.
You have been weighed in the balances and found wanting.
Or you have been numbered.
Numbered.
Numbered or numberer. So this Palamoni is the wonderful numberer. That is Christ that's being referenced. Mm. So the person in the prophecy, the person speaking the answer in Daniel 8:14 is none other than Christ himself. But what's interesting is this. The way it's phrased here in Daniel chapter 8, it is posed as a question that says, how long? The original language can never support this question the way it's asked, Danny, because the original question isn't how long as in a duration. but it is rather till when, which is a point in time.
Right.
And there's a big difference. We're not asking how long is a duration, we're asking till when, a point in time.
Mm.
So the question...
Because we don't know yet...
That's right.
...when this time frame is going to begin or when it's going to end.
That's right.
That information... It's not revealed. Hasn't been revealed.
That's right. So what I wanted to go to here real quick... How long shall be the vision? And that's from the King James. So even the King James translates it incorrectly. Another thing that is wrong with the way it's translated is this idea of evenings, mornings. Okay, the original language doesn't refer to a plural form of Arab boker, which is evening, morning. It is always and only translated in the singular form, Arab boker, or unto cleansing of the sanctuary day, a specific day, one day, and there was evening, Arab boker, morning. There was evening, morning, day one, right? If we go back to the Genesis account. So it's not, it can never be plural. So it's not saying 2,300 evenings and mornings or days. It's referencing a very specific day. And so here's the answer to the question that's asked. The question is asked, till when? What point in time will all of this come to an end? This little horn power that's making war against Christ and his people, and that's trampling upon the truth and casting it to the ground. At what point in time does this come to an end? Till when? And then the answer comes back. Unto cleansing of the sanctuary day 2,300. So built right into the text.
So instead of it being 2,300 literal days.
That's right.
It's 2,300 cleansing days.
That's right.
Which
anniversaries.
Means, which happens once a year.
Which happens once a year.
So it's 2,300 years.
That's right. Exactly right. So the point in time at which all of this in Daniel 8, concluding with 8:14, all of that comes to an end at a very particular point. And that point, according to the original language, the way it's worded, is it will come to an end at precisely this time. Cleansing of the sanctuary day 2,300.
Wow.
So you don't even need the year day principle. Amen. It's built right into the text. The answer is, and it was Christ himself who gave that answer.
Wow. That is extremely powerful. Now, let me grab my notes here, because this little bit of information that you shared with me is pretty exciting. So, in verse 16, chapter 8, verse 16, Gabriel comes to Daniel. Because this vision that Daniel receives distresses him.
Mm.
The beasts, mm-hmm. especially this last one mm-hmm. that does all these terrible things to God's saints.
Yes.
This is extremely distressing to Daniel. So in verse 16, I heard a man's voice between the banks of the Ulai.
Mm-hmm.
So this is what we see in the picture. Which called and said, Gabriel, make this man to understand the vision. So Daniel, standing by the banks of the Ulai, Gabriel appears to him, and Daniel hears a voice. And the voice tells Daniel, Gabriel, explain this to Daniel. So he begins to explain. So he came near and he stood when he came. And I was afraid and I fell on my face. But he said to me, understand, O son of man, For at the time of the end shall be the vision. Mm-hmm. So whatever this vision is, Rowdy, mm-hmm. the vision's going to bring us to the end. Mm-hmm. By the way, this whole conversation that we've been having in respect to Daniel and this information that's being given to him is in respect to a vision.
That's right.
We also need to keep that in mind. Mm-hmm. Because we're going to move from Daniel chapter 8 mm-hmm. into Daniel chapter 9, and we're mm-hmm. still going to be talking about what? The vision. Mm-hmm. The vision that all we know up till now is 2,300 days of atonement. Mm-hmm. Then that sanctuary, which was supposed to be cleansed every year mm-hmm. on the Day of Atonement, mm-hmm. symbolically, in the sanctuary service, mm-hmm. was actually going to be cleansed on the 2,300th mm-hmm. Day of Atonement.
That's right.
I'm still absorbing that information that you shared. It's powerful.
The making right or the setting right of the sanctuary and all of its truth and its application that has been lost for all that time will come back into focus and will be set right. And the cleansing of the sanctuary will begin again. The typical
right
will now come into sharp focus at a specific time.
Amen. So that's getting exciting now, Rowdy. I'm getting pumped up about this.
Good deal.
So the context of everything we're going to learn from Daniel's vision, from Daniel chapter 8 and chapter 9, is in respect to this vision about 2,300 years.
Yeah.
We don't know yet when it starts. So because we don't know when it starts, there's no way to know when it's going to end.
That's right.
But we know there's a period of time.
Yes.
2,300 years in duration, mm-hmm. where 2,300 days of atonements will pass.
That's right. And it will have a starting time, which isn't revealed. And from that start time,
we'll find our ending point.
We'll find our ending point.
Now, we're going to move forward in this study, and we're going to discover what they are. Mm-hmm. As a matter of fact, that's going to be the focus of the rest of the study. Mm-hmm. But this is powerful. Because what they did in the earthly sanctuary service from year to year mm-hmm. was typical. It was symbolic. It was earthly. It was ceremonial. What's going to happen on the 2,300th year is the reality.
That's right.
That the symbolic gesture pointed forward to.
That's right.
That's why the psalmist said that God could never be satisfied with the slaying of bulls and goats.
That's right.
Well, goats, that was on the last day.
Mm-hmm. Right.
That was on the Day of Atonement. God couldn't be satisfied with this. What needed to happen is the sanctuary in heaven, where ultimately the record of all sin is kept, mm-hmm. is to be cleansed.
Yes.
So, what Daniel's being given in this vision encompasses the entire prophetic chart. We've looked at several. Daniel mm-hmm. chapter 2 with the statue. Then we looked at the lion, the bear, mm-hmm. the leopard, and the indescript beast. And then we looked at the ram and the goat mm-hmm. and this third terrible thing that comes mm-hmm. along at the end.
Right.
Okay, that's what we're doing here in Daniel 8. He sees this vision with the same timeline mm-hmm. that we've looked at time and time again. And he's distressed about it, Daniel is.
Yeah. You know, it's interesting about him being distressed. So this first part of the vision happens in the third year of Belshazzar. And so in the third year of Belshazzar, you know, as these conversations are taking place, and then Gabriel is told to come and make him understand, we get down to 27 where he is so distressed that he can't continue.
He faints.
Now, that was the third year of Belshazzar.
Uh-huh.
And it wasn't until the first year of Darius where the vision picks back up again. That was 12 years worth of time between the beginning of the explanation of the 2,300 years and when he recovered enough and was brave enough to continue the conversation with the angel.
Well, what we find next, when you launch into chapter 9, the first, I don't know, 20-something verses,
mm-hmm.
is Daniel praying.
Yeah.
Because whatever he understood about what was revealed and what we can our contemporary Bibles refer to as Daniel chapter 8.
Yeah.
Whatever he was shown, whatever he understood about what he was shown, mm-hmm. so distressed him that 12 years later, as Rowdy's now pointed out, he's praying about this.
Mm-hmm.
And this beautifully long, repentant prayer
mm-hmm.
is mm-hmm. prayed in the first part of Daniel 9.
Mm-hmm.
But when you get down to about 21,
mm-hmm.
it picks up like this. Yea, while I was speaking in prayer, even the man, Gabriel, who I had seen in the vision at the beginning, being caused to fly swiftly, touched me about the time of the evening oblation.
Mm-hmm.
And he informed me. What did he do, Rowdy?
Informed.
He informed and talked with me, and he said, O Daniel, I am now come forth to give thee skill and understanding.
Mm-hmm.
So what's Daniel about to receive, Rowdy?
Skill in understanding.
Why?
Because he doesn't in himself possess it.
He does not, and he's been distressed about this thing mm-hmm. that he doesn't understand. He's been shown, God blessed him, mm-hmm. God showed him something miraculous, but he doesn't understand it. So much distress has been placed upon this brother
mm-hmm.
because of his lack of understanding that he actually fainted.
Yeah.
Yeah. The same guy that was up all night with lions
mm-hmm.
fainted over a vision.
Mm-hmm.
12 years later, he's still praying about this vision.
That's right. Yeah.
And the angel comes, and I could imagine Daniel finishing his prayer and open his eyes and Gabriel standing there.
Yeah.
And he's like, okay, mm-hmm. let me explain. Remember what we were talking about last time we were on the phone together, you know
yeah.
what I mean?
Yeah.
Like you have a cell phone call that ended
yeah.
and you pick up the cell phone, it's like, okay, where did we leave off? Where
yeah.
were we?
Yeah.
That's the scenario with Gabriel when he shows up to Daniel. And he says, I'm going to give you understanding about these things.
Now, here's something to keep in mind. When the vision ended, part of what had been revealed to Daniel was the overall overarching time frame concerning this vision and the works of this little horn. And so Daniel understood that all of this stuff concerning this power was going to cover a period of 2,300 years. So he understood that. He didn't understand yet when it was going to begin or when it was going to end, but he did understand this one thing, that entire vision covers a period of time, which is 2,300 years. So now when we come into Daniel chapter 9, and the vision begins to be explained to him again, don't lose sight of the fact that it's the same vision, the original vision being talked about, and the same time period, therefore, it is 2,300 years that is being referenced. Now we go to...
Thank you.
The beginning of it.
That's very important. And my brother Les Flatt, one of the things I used to love when I would listen to him share a Bible study about the 2300-year prophecy, is there's a word, the word vision, that's used in both of these chapters.
Right. The Mere and the Kazon.
Right. One of them is talking about the entire vision.
Yes.
The other one is like this portion of the vision.
Yes.
It's still in reference to the whole vision.
Yes.
But it's only going to describe a portion.
A portion.
Of that longer vision.
That's right.
So that's important to know.
Yes.
As this angel begins to describe to Daniel what's going to happen during this time frame of 2300 days, because this is what the angel does. He says, okay, you just prayed a big long prayer, and the prayer was mostly about forgiving your people. Mm-hmm. God, forgive us for our sins, for turning away from you. Mm-hmm. We rightfully deserve being put in captivity.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so Daniel is laying out his heart to God because he desires God's blessing to come back on his people. Now, who's Daniel? What kind of people is Daniel?
Jew, Israelite.
Daniel is an Israelite. Yeah. So he desires God's blessing to come back to Israel.
Yes.
He, like most of us, is mostly concerned about myself and my people. I am mostly concerned about myself and my children in the back room and my wife. I am also concerned about a lot of other things and a lot of people, you being one of them. But primary focus, most of the time, is myself and my family in the back room.
That's right.
This is what Daniel's thinking, and that's what he expressed in his prayer. Go to Daniel chapter 9 and read the whole prayer. He's wanting God to turn his face back towards Israel. Okay? So this angel, specifically, as he begins to explain that whole vision, he's going to talk about a particular portion of that longer vision that's specifically for Daniel and Daniel's people.
That's right. You know, Daniel here starts out in chapter 9. He says that he had been studying the books of his people, and he came to understand that according to the word of Jeremiah, that the 70 years of desolation of Jerusalem were going to come to an end. So this is what prompts Daniel to begin praying. He realizes that this captivity that they're in had a beginning, and it was also going to have an end. And he realized that in studying the book of Jeremiah, that that end was fast approaching. And so he begins praying, and he's making supplication, and he's asking his God to remember his promise and remember his mercy and to bring about this accomplishment of the end of the 70 years. And it's interesting that that tidbit of information is given, Danny, because as Daniel is contemplating the end of a 70-year period, it's like God comes and picks up with the same concept and begins reintroducing the vision with another 70-year period, but which would take place.
Exactly right. There's
at a particular time. So 70 years was going to come to an end, and the beginning of a 70
prophetic
time period would start with the end of this 70-year literal time.
Isn't that powerful?
The wonderful number, the number of secrets, that's our God. He's fantastic with numbers.
He's fantastic. There's one other detail that I didn't want to pass up because I thought it was so profound. I read this earlier, I guess. No, I didn't get to this verse. So back to chapter 9, this time we're looking at verse 23.
Mm-hmm.
Gabriel says to Daniel, at the beginning of thy supplication, in other words, Daniel, when you began praying, the commandment came forth.
Immediately.
And I am come to show thee, for thou art greatly beloved. Therefore, understand the matter and consider the vision. Mm-hmm. Two things here.
Yeah.
This is a tribute to my brother Frank Webb. Frank shared a testimony with me years ago, and I know he shared it with you, Roddy, because he shares it with everyone. Mm-hmm. Because it's his testimony.
Right.
And when Frank shares Frank's testimony, this is part of Frank's testimony. And I love Frank, and one of the things I love about Frank is his testimony. Frank was praying at some stage in his religious experience, wanting to be closer with the Lord, wanting to know God's will, wanting a true experience, a real experience with the Lord Jesus. And Frank was praying, and he was led to this verse. And he was impressed, first with God's speed. Frank's a pilot.
Yeah.
Frank understands speed.
Mm-hmm.
And when it dawned on Frank that as Daniel started to pray, at the beginning of thy supplication, the commandment came forth,
yes,
and I am come to thee. Daniel had just started to pray, and if you go back and read Daniel chapter 9, he prayed for a while.
Mm-hmm.
His prayer had already been answered.
Yeah.
At the beginning.
Wow.
Gabriel was already on his way.
Wow.
And why? Because thou art greatly beloved.
Yeah.
When Frank Webb considered the Lord's speed, and the Lord acts on our behalf because we are greatly beloved. When Frank read that, the Lord spoke to his heart and said, Frank Webb, Rowdy Schmidt, Danny Henson, Saturday Night Live viewer, you are just as greatly beloved as Daniel. I do not love Daniel more than I love you.
That's right.
The Bible says he is no
respecter
of persons.
Wow.
He loves you. The next thing the angel says is this, Rowdy. 70 weeks are determined upon thy people.
Mm-hmm.
We know who you're worried about. The Lord knows. Mm-hmm. He heard your prayer. Mm-hmm. He answered it before you finished it.
Yeah.
Before you were done talking,
mm-hmm.
I was sent. The commandment had gone forth.
That's right.
When you opened your eyes, here I'm standing.
Mm-hmm.
Standing on the banks of the Ulai. Mm-hmm. Gabriel was standing before Daniel, prepared to answer. And what does he say? 70 weeks are determined upon thy people and upon the holy city,
mm-hmm.
to finish transgression,
mm-hmm.
to make an end of sins, and to make reconciliation,
mm-hmm.
for iniquity, and to bring in everlasting righteousness, and to seal up the vision and prophecy, and to anoint, mm-hmm. the most holy.
Yes.
So, know therefore and understand that from the going forth,
mm-hmm.
of the command to restore and to rebuild Jerusalem. Now here we go, Rowdy. We're about to get a very important piece of the puzzle.
That's right.
If you don't get this, this whole 2300 year thing has no relevance for us.
That's right.
Because 2300 years when? Where in the timeline does this 2300 chunk of years deserve to fit? How are we to understand this vision? When's it going to happen? When's it going to start? When's it going to come to an end? How would we know when the prophecy's fulfilled? Mm-hmm. This is how.
Mm-hmm.
Because Gabriel is about to give Daniel the starting point. Know and understand that from the going forth of the commandment to restore and to build Jerusalem mm-hmm. unto the Messiah, the Prince, mm-hmm. shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. Now let's do the math there.
So that would be 69 weeks.
Yes, it would.
So Gabriel comes and he says that 70 weeks are determined, and that's literally translated as cut off. So that 70 weeks is cut off of something else.
The larger vision.
The larger vision. So he begins with a portion of time taken from the larger period. Both periods start at the same place.
They run consecutively.
That's right.
Yes.
The 2300 years start with the same time as the 70 weeks.
Yes.
70 weeks are cut off, are determined, are the beginning point for this 2300 year prophecy.
Yes.
And it is specifically relating to your people, Daniel.
Yes, to the Jewish people. Thank you. So, Ezra chapter 7 gives us a historical mm-hmm. account of Artaxerxes' command to rebuild and to restore Jerusalem. Ezra the priest and later Nehemiah were conscripted with the necessary provisions to do that work. Mm-hmm. And in Ezra chapter 7, this entire historic event is laid out. Now, history tells us that that work began, the decree to rebuild Jerusalem by Artaxerxes, began in 457 BC. Okay? So, when Gabriel says, wrong page. When Daniel says that after 62 weeks,
mm-hmm.
This is still not the one I'm trying to read, 25. Mm-hmm. Understand, no, from the goings forth of the commandment to restore and rebuild Jerusalem until Messiah the Prince, there will be 7 weeks and 62. That's 62.
That's right.
A score is 20.
Right.
60, and yep. 62. And so you've got 60. You've got 7, and you've got 62 for a total of what? 69 weeks. Then after the 62 weeks, Messiah will be cut off.
Mm-hmm.
So, let's do some math here. 62 weeks, 69 weeks, would be 483 years
mm-hmm.
or 483 days.
Mm-hmm.
And this particular prophecy is also going to incorporate the day for a year. Obviously, we learn that at the beginning of the prophecy of the 2300 days or years. So 483 years, 69 weeks is 483 years. And what you'll have left is 7 weeks.
1 week.
1 week, I'm sorry.
Which is 7 years.
7 years,
yes.
Right.
Yes.
So, if you go forward from 457 BC, 69 weeks, or 483 years, that brings you to what date?
27 AD, which would have been the baptism.
Exactly right.
The anointing of
Messiah. On 27 AD, Jesus was anointed that year at the Jordan River, at the baptism, when the Spirit descended upon him.
And begins his public ministry as Messiah, the Prince.
Okay, that's what it says. And shall 7 weeks and 62 weeks, the street shall be built again in the wall, and even in troublous times. And after 62 weeks shall Messiah be cut off. Okay, now, this is interesting. So we've got the 483 years until Jesus' ministry begins. And then we've got those last 7 years. Right?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, Jesus' ministry only lasted 3.5 of those 7 years. Why? Because he was cut off in the midst of the week. Okay? Verse 27. And he shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week. And in the midst of the week, he shall cause the sacrifice and the oblation to cease.
Yes.
Now, Rowdy, we talked about this last study when we studied about the veil that separated the holy from the most holy.
That's right.
And we talked about how the day that Jesus was crucified, some unseen hand entered into the permanent temple there in Jerusalem, and it ripped the veil that separated those two compartments from top to bottom.
That's right. If we go back to Daniel 24, that's what's being referenced. Listen to this. 70 weeks are determined for your people and your holy city, and certain things are going to happen. We're going to bring an end to transgression, to make an end of sin, to make reconciliation for iniquity, to bring in everlasting righteousness, to seal up the vision and the prophecy, and to anoint the most holy.
Anoint.
All of those things happen in that last week.
Amen.
And are the work of the Messiah. It is the work of the Messiah, and it was particularly referencing his death when the most holy was anointed. As you were saying, the most holy place was anointed with blood, the blood of sacrifice. And it was Christ's sacrifice, his shed blood, and at that time, the veil being rent. And it was at that moment when the most holy place in heaven was anointed to continue his priestly ministry.
Not only that, but the earthly ministry and all of those sacrificial, symbolic services that pointed forward to the Messiah were rendered insignificant.
That's right.
Because the Messiah had actually come.
That's right.
God's presence was no longer with the Jewish people.
That's right.
The way it had been in the past.
That's right.
And it was evident when that veil was ripped, because guess what ceased to be in the most holy?
God's presence.
The Shekinah glory was no longer hovering above the mercy seat.
That's right.
It was gone. That's why there's no sacrificial services being held in the temple in Jerusalem today. Number one, because there's no more temple.
That's right.
It was destroyed, which the prophecy goes on to describe. It was destroyed, and the Jewish services, the oblation, or how does it word it in the sentence? The oblation to cease shall cause sacrifice and oblation to cease.
That's right.
When the Messiah was cut off in the midst of the week,
that's right,
not for himself, but for his people. It's at that time the veil was rent, God's presence was no longer in the sanctuary, sacrificial services, killing of goats and rams and bulls and such,
that's right,
became insignificant to God because the real sacrifice had come. And in the midst of the week, he was cut off.
That's right. In the middle of that last week, which is 7 years, in the middle of that 7 week period, 3.5 years into his ministry, is when he was crucified.
Absolutely right. That's why you have the cross in the middle of the week. In the middle of that 7 years is the cross. Christ's ministry continues, though, for another 3.5 years exclusively to the Jews.
Because the promise is that he will confirm the covenant
for one week with his people.
That's right.
So Jesus' ministry continued through the working of the apostles.
That's right.
For 3.5 more years to the Jewish nation. God is so merciful to continue to plead with those people after them yelling, "Crucify him! Crucify him!"
Right.
His mercy, the Bible says, endureth forever.
That's right.
Praise the Lord. He gives mercy.
That's right.
He shows mercy to the Jewish people for 3.5 more years. His ministry continues until one day he sends his servant Stephen to speak to the leaders of his people. And one of the most powerful sermons in the book of Acts was given to this man of God who preached with power and conviction. And the souls of the men in attendance to hear that sermon's hearts were pricked to the core. And what did they do to him, brother?
Stoned him.
They stoned Stephen to death for his troubles. So in 34 AD at the stoning of Stephen, Stephen, as he's dying, prays to the God of heaven and says, "God, hold not this sin against these men who are murdering me." And God does one more kindness for Stephen, brother. Stephen, in his last moments of life, goes into vision. And he yells out to those who are killing him, "I see heaven opened and Christ standing, not sitting." Not sitting in judgment, but standing. Friends, anytime you're reading the Bible and Michael, the prince of his people, stands up. When Christ stands up from his throne, something just happened. Something prophetic that was foretold has now been fulfilled when Christ stands up.
That's right.
Stephen sees Christ stand up. And he breathes his last. The Jews are warned, "I see him standing." That means that this 490 years. Doesn't that give you a whole new understanding? Remember when Peter comes to Jesus and he says, "How many times should I forgive my brother?" You know, because Peter had some brethren that he didn't like that much, Rowdy.
That's right.
Matthew, the tax collector, might have been one of them. And he says, "How many times do I need to forgive my neighbor, my brother?"
Yep.
Seven times? He thought he was going to be pretty righteous by blurting seven times out. Seven times? I can do that.
Yeah.
I can do seven. What does Jesus look to him and say?
Not seven times, but 70 times
70 times 7. Do the math in your head real quick. Mm. 70 times 7. Guess how many times that is?
490
times.
Wow.
Jesus was given him a look into Bible prophecy, into the book of Daniel.
About these 490 years.
About the 70-week prophecy. 470 times 7. That's 490 years.
Yes.
That this longer 2,300-year vision, that 490 was cut off for Daniel's people, the Jews.
That's right.
And when they finally rejected Christ after the crucifixion and 3.5 more years of sermons coming to their ears about the Messiah, then they dragged this faithful servant out and they stoned him to death.
Yes.
And Jesus says, okay.
Yep.
Your time is up.
Yep.
70 times 7. 490 years. Now, 490 years is what was given to the Jews to bring about righteousness, reconciliation, and an end to sin. Mm. And by faith, Christ has accomplished all of that work right there in the 70-year vision.
Yeah.
This vision is important for us, brethren, because during that 490-year span of time, when that prophecy was finally fulfilled in 34 AD, that gospel goes to me and you. To the Gentile world, the gospel is now wide open and available. You are received into the beloved, fellow Gentile. That gospel belongs to you, just like it does to the Jew.
Yeah, the 490 years that were set apart specifically and exclusively for the Jewish nation.
Yes.
The covenants and promises made to them for 490 years would remain in effect, and in the last 7 years of that time would be confirmed by none other than the person that gave them in the beginning.
The prophecy
that he would come himself in the person of Christ and confirm those very promises and the promise of covenant to his people.
Yeah.
Himself for 1 year.
Powerful. Now, it's important for us to understand that 70-week prophecy. Mm-hmm. There are so many Bible commentators and preachers in the world today that take that 7 years, that last week, the 70th week.
Yeah. The very week that specifically mentions Messiah the Prince.
And describes his work.
And describes his work, his crucifixion, his bringing in of everlasting righteousness, his sacrifice which puts an end to the oblations and sacrifices. All of that descriptive language referring to Christ, they somehow take that and apply that to a completely different time period and to the enemy himself.
Here's the interesting part. The first 69 weeks, they leave it in its historical context.
Yes, they do. Right where it should be.
Right where it should be. Starting from the going forth to rebuild Jerusalem.
Yeah.
So from 457 up till 483... they're okay, but that last 7 days that gives us the gospel, they take it all the way down to the end of time, and mysteriously, this 7 years is when the rapture is going to take place, the Antichrist is going to reveal himself, there's going to be a time of trouble, and then the third coming.
Complete biblical illiteracy like I have never seen in my life. Craziness.
Some of you have heard about this. Some of you may have heard it preached in your church last Sunday. Biblically, there is no grounds to support that theology.
No, not at all.
What we just read is so cut and dry.
Yeah.
There should be no mistake. And if you can Google the original language, the portion of the longer vision is what's being explained in chapter 9 by Gabriel to Daniel when Daniel's given understanding in reference and in reaction to the prayer that he just prayed, right, which is, please save me and my people.
Yeah. You know, David, this makes perfect sense, though, when we realize what has taken place. And it's that this little horn power casts the truth of the sanctuary to the ground.
Yes, it does.
And destroys the beautiful truth of the sanctuary. And in doing so, pulls Christ down and destroys the work and atonement of Christ contained in that 7-year period. So this entire 2,300 year prophetic period, which honors and glorifies God and reveals the work of Christ, this little horn power would pull the sanctuary truths to the ground, tramples upon them, in doing so tramples upon Christ. It makes sense that the enemy is desperate to cover up the truth of the sanctuary in this 2,300 year prophecy, because it says that at a certain time Christ comes, Christ accomplishes this amazing work, and then that whole work of this little horn power comes to an end. The trampling of the sanctuary truth and the day of judgment and the day of atonement, all of that is reestablished at a particular point in time. But when you take this 7 years and you insert a 2,000 year gap for no biblical reason, what it does is it completely destroys that entire 2,300 year prophecy. It now becomes a 3,400 year prophecy plus.
Yeah.
And it just destroys it. And it destroys the fact that that prophecy was to tell us that the truths of the sanctuary with its atonement and its day of judgment is going to be reestablished for the truth that it is at a particular point in time, which we haven't taken the time to identify yet when that happened.
Well, that's where we're going now. Because obviously, the 70-week prophecy being fulfilled we now turn back to the larger portion of the vision. The entire vision, the 2,300 days, beginning at 457 BC, if you count 2,300 years forward from 457, we come to the year 1844. So, if this prophecy is correct, and God has never been wrong, something must happen significant that has some type of connection with Day of Atonement theology in order for this to make any sense. So, was there indeed anything that happened in the 1840s of significance?
Yes.
The answer is yes. Something known and can be Googled as the Second Great Awakening. Yeah. Now, this began to build in the early 30s, 1830s, to its crescendo in the 1850s. And it's described with the reformation of American politics and restructuring of the economy. Also, there was a religious change. religious reformers wanted to improve the ordinary American's religious commitment and theology. So notice, this Great Awakening in the 1800s wanted to improve the religious American's commitment and theology. They pushed against the reliance on reason because Thomas Paine had written the, you know, this great piece of garbage that brought about this age of reason and enlightenment. And this caused a slew of religious activities which converted millions during this awakening. It began in the American Southern frontier, and it became known as the Second Great Awakening. By its end, 3/4 of Americans attended church. Now, interesting to note, what was the impact of the Second Great Awakening? Spiritual reform from within was the focus. Religious revivalism was the rally cry. What did they want to reform? What did they want to revise? Well, many social reforms were made and a redefining of the ideal of equality. It's obvious to note that America was guilty of the crime of slavery.
Yes.
Movements began in the 1840s to reverse this racist behavior, and it was known as abolitionism. So there was an abolition against slavery. Temperance was a focus of this religious revival. Asylum and penal reform, obviously connected with abolition. Women's rights and education. So it's interesting to me that on the Day of Atonement, afflicting your soul by fasting, by reforming your behavior, the way that you dress, it was an act of humility and temperance. Mm-hmm. And this was exactly the theme of the Second Awakening during the 1840s. And it led to 3/4 of the populace back in church, studying their Bible, education, theological advancements, many things that had been covered by the Dark Ages. In other words, because of ignorance and the inability to access Scripture, people were in darkness about many things. They didn't have the advantages, Rowdy, that you and I have, where we can open up a tablet, read any version of the Bible we'd like.
That's right.
Look the words up in Hebrew, in Greek, in Aramaic.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't have this.
Right.
If you owned a Bible, you could be imprisoned or killed.
Mm-hmm.
That's why it's called the Dark Ages.
That's right.
People were in darkness to the truth.
Yeah.
When people fled that religious persecution and came to this country, they continued in large part in darkness.
Mm-hmm.
Because whatever theology had been accepted by the religious leaders just perpetuated itself.
That's right.
In the churches.
Yeah.
And there was a reluctance to move deeper into the Word of God to find more light and to uncover the truths that had been obscured by the Dark Ages.
Right.
So then this Age of Reason came about in this country,
yeah,
where thanks to the French Revolution and things of this secular progressive thinking, people started to move away from Scripture, and everything could be reasoned.
Mm-hmm.
So you could, I think, therefore I am, and all these philosophies came forward that just obscured the Scripture once again.
Mm-hmm.
The Second Awakening
mm-hmm.
brought people back to their first love,
mm-hmm.
back to the Word of God, back to church,
mm-hmm.
back to the Bible, and these doctrines that had been hidden in darkness mm-hmm. began to be brought to the light.
That's right.
Now, obviously, that brings us to the great Second Advent movement mm-hmm. and its rise and progress. You can learn more about this particular history with online. It's free. There's a book called The Great Second Advent Movement by J.N. Loughborough. Fantastic book. Encouraged that you read or listen to this book. If you'd like to know more about this this Day of Atonement and the rise of the Advent movement, this is where multiple denominations, Methodist, Baptist, Orthodox, Judaism, people from basically every walk of life came together, studying the scripture, finding new truths, finding, researching the Sabbath and how the church had changed the commandments of God, replaced them with the commandments of men. All these things came about, and we started to understand the scripture, Daniel 8:14, the cleansing of the sanctuary. That question became forefront in the entire religious world for several years.
That's right. You know, and it wasn't just here in America. That same awakening that we experienced here in the late 1830s, beginning late 1830s with the Millerite movement, it wasn't unique to North America. That same experience and the uncovering of those truths was happening all over the world.
That's right.
It was incredible.
Yes, indeed. It was several different people from different walks of life. Mm-hmm. There were men involved of European descent. There were African American men involved. Mm-hmm. God spoke to lots of different kinds of people, even to women.
That's right.
And we're showing them the same things, the same Bible truths at the same time.
That's right.
And they would run into each other at these camp meetings. Now, this became a phenomenon mm-hmm. during the 1830s and 40s. People would go to camp meetings, large meetings where people would come and speak for weeks at a time and invite everyone from the community to come out, and it would just be powerful Bible teachings from a pulpit mm-hmm. for days and weeks mm-hmm. sometimes, mm-hmm. and hundreds and thousands of people were converted in such ways mm-hmm. and became parts of these various movements, and certainly the Great Advent Movement was one of the more notable. Mm-hmm. I say more notable because it's had a profound profound effect on my life as well. I've spent many years studying its history mm-hmm. and its theology, and it's been a tremendous blessing to me mm-hmm. and would encourage everyone that hears our voice to do the same. That awakening was noted by visions and dreams as well. I was trying to think his name, Leroy Fry.
You thinking of Froom?
No, I'm not thinking of Froom. As a matter of fact, I rarely think of Froom because I'm not a big fan of his work.
I'm with you.
There was an African American gentleman, Froy was his name, I think, not Froom. Can't think of his first name right offhand. He was given some visions. Then a woman named Ellen Gould Harmon was given a vision. Ellen was preaching at a church one day where he was in attendance. Mm-hmm. And he was jumping and hopping and excited because she went through a vision that she had mm-hmm. step by step and word for word. And this young African-American brother had seen the exact same vision mm-hmm. and had recorded it. He had written it all down in detail. And she, as she expressed what she was shown in vision, was point by point describing his vision. Mm-hmm. Things like this happened. There was a man named Hiram Edson. Mm-hmm. Before the Advent movement launched, there was a predecessor called the Millerite movement. Mm-hmm. And this man, William Miller, studied Daniel 8:14, the scripture that we focused on tonight, the 2300 days, and he came to the conclusion that Jesus would return to this earth mm-hmm. in 1844. Mm-hmm. Okay, and he researched the Days of Atonement, the mm-hmm. 2300 Days of Atonement,
right.
starting in 457, moving forward.
That's right.
And he came to a precise date, mm-hmm. October 22nd, mm-hmm.
1844. That's right. And the way he interpreted the cleansing of the sanctuary, mistakenly, was that the sanctuary must be the earth.
Correct.
And the cleansing must be by fire. Therefore, that must be Christ coming back to judge and cleanse the earth with the fires that are talked about in the various books of the Bible, referring to judgment and the destroying of the wicked by fire. So the assumption, the conclusions that he drew.
Correct. Had Brother Miller known his sanctuary doctrine better,
that's right,
he would understand that at the end of time, there had to be a portion of time allotted mm-hmm. for God's people to afflict their souls.
That's right.
To be cleansed of their sins.
That's right.
And for that high priest to make mediatorial mm-hmm. cleansing mm-hmm. for them in the holiest of all.
That's right.
Which doesn't exist on this earth, my friends.
That's right.
It exists above.
That's right. So there is a cleansing that is to take place pertaining to the sanctuary of God.
Correct.
They just did not interpret what the sanctuary was correctly or what the judgment meant pertaining to the
sanctuary. No, they did not, brother, but I'll tell you where. They get my respect. Mm-hmm. They get my respect because these men and women sacrifice their livelihood. Mm-hmm. Many of them let all their earthly belongings go. Mm-hmm. Many of them who were farmers by trade mm-hmm. left their crops to stand in the field and ruin mm-hmm. because they didn't believe they had another year left. Mm-hmm. Nor would they need the proceeds or the crops. Mm-hmm. So they left them stand.
Yeah.
And on October 22nd, 1844, mm-hmm. they went to their respective places mm-hmm. to wait for Jesus to show up.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know what? Be wrong, but be wrong like that if you're going to be wrong.
Yeah. Yeah.
And they were wrong. Mm-hmm. And they were disappointed. Mm-hmm. And many of them left the movement. Mm-hmm. Some of them left Christ completely.
Yeah.
Because of their disappointment. Yeah. Later on, sometime later, one of the Millerites was walking in his cornfields, mm-hmm. looking at the wasted corn, I suppose. Mm-hmm. And he was taken into vision. And in vision, he was shown that the sanctuary that was to be cleansed was not the sanctuary of the earth being cleansed by fire, mm-hmm. but the sanctuary which was the true, not the pattern. Mm-hmm. Remember when Moses was taken on the mount, mm-hmm. he was shown to build after the pattern which he was shown on the mount.
That's right.
The pattern that he was shown on the mount was the true in heaven.
That's right.
He was to look at the true tabernacle, take God's instructions to build a smaller one to scale mm-hmm. that would be used here on this earth.
Right.
To represent the one in heaven. The one where Christ is the high priest. Mm-hmm. And the throne where the two stacks of bread, the Father and the Son, would sit. And then the most holy, where the Day of Atonement meant that God's people would afflict their souls as their sins were being completely removed and cleansed forever.
That's right.
Now listen, folks. In the 1840s, that sanctuary cleansing began.
That's right.
Rowdy and I have suggested to you on multiple occasions that we believe we are rapidly approaching the second coming of Jesus Christ, and this is just another piece of the puzzle.
Yeah.
1840, that was a long time ago. Mm-hmm. The work that Christ is doing will be completed. We will be atoned for, and we will be at one with the Father. Mm-hmm. When there is a group of people in which this work could be accomplished, then this witness will be seen by the world, the whole world, and according to Matthew 24, then the end will come.
That's right.
God will accomplish that works, my friend.
So where does that leave us? It leaves us with this very, very real and significant, heavy, weighty truth. That the 2,300-year period that started in 457 B.C., ended in 1844.
That's correct.
In 1844, the typological Day of Atonement that was represented in that yearly service, that one last Day of Atonement, the cleansing of the sanctuary, that typology, that typological day began for us here on planet Earth, the Day of Atonement in 1844.
Right.
So we have been living since 1844 in that period of time represented by that one day in the sanctuary service.
Correct.
That one day of judgment, that one day of final atonement, where our high priest is in the most holy place, wrapping things up for his people. That one day has been represented to us in effect since 1844, Daniel. We've been living in that day of judgment.
I believe that with my whole heart. You know, it's interesting in the book of Hebrews, Paul, touched on this just for a moment. And he said, of which things we cannot now speak. Mm-hmm. When it comes to the work that God was going to do, typified or symbolically described in that sanctuary service on the Day of Atonement at the end of the year, Paul said, of these things we can't now speak in great detail. Mm-hmm. It wasn't present truth for Paul.
That's right.
He couldn't in great detail describe the work of God in the most holy place because when Christ ascended to heaven, he went to begin his ministry in the holy.
That's right.
In the first compartment of the sanctuary.
That's right.
It wouldn't be till the close of that prophecy in Daniel chapter 8, verse 14, mm-hmm. when the fulfillment of that last work of atonement would be performed.
That's right.
So Paul couldn't himself speak in any detail mm-hmm. of that work of Christ's ministry.
That's right.
Because it had not yet commenced.
That's right.
He couldn't speak to it.
That's right. Any more than Daniel could.
Any more than Daniel could. So I believe God raised up this movement in the 1840s, mm-hmm. prepared to understand and to talk
That's right.
about the final closing work of atonement
yes.
that Jesus Christ is doing in the heavenly sanctuary
That's right.
for us.
That's right.
the only mediator between God and man.
Yes.
The man Christ Jesus.
That's right.
Folks, Rowdy and I commend tonight, commend to you the man Christ Jesus.
Yes.
The only mediator. God bless you.
Whoever is unjust, let him be unjust still. Whoever is righteous, let him be righteous still. Whoever is filthy, let him be filthy still. Listen to the words long written down. And the man